Today's episode is sponsored by Future State Media, experts in off-Amazon traffic for Amazon sellers. Future State Media will build you a custom-made website to deliver sales for you on Amazon. Built to grab traffic from search engines and social media, your site can be used as a secret weapon for launching products on Amazon or just to stabilize your Amazon sales. It means you can also build an email list on autopilot. Go to futurestatemedia.com for your free guide to Google SEO for Amazon sellers today. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the show. This is your host, Michael Veazey, and I'm delighted today to introduce a really different guest from my usual one, which is Tommy Griffith. He was the founder of ClickMinded and the former SEO manager at PayPal and at Airbnb, just to kind of overachieve. So quite an amazingly strong background in SEO. So Tommy, warm welcome to the show. Great to have you.
Michael, thanks so much for having me on the show. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's a great pleasure. So when you reached out, I thought, this doesn't sound relevant to Amazon sellers. And I thought, actually, hang on, 2019, everyone needs to think bigger picture and think more about, you know, a more sophisticated business model, a more sustainable one. And then I read some of your story, which I thought was very interesting. And entrepreneurs sort of real life, actual, how you build a business rather than the pretty version, which I really liked. So that's why I got you on the show. So we're going to have a variety of topics that we're going to listen to. So folks, listen out for a few different episodes here. Let's start with some of the more generally e-commerce focused stuff. Obviously, you are, you know, really seriously strong background of SEO. So let's just have a quick, I know you haven't sold on Amazon for a couple of years, but you were pretty serious on it a couple of years ago. Let's look at the overview of what you think the evergreen ranking factors are on Amazon. Obviously, the latest hacks aren't something we can speak to with a couple of years distance, but what do you think are the most important evergreen and ranking factors on Amazon that you think are true now and are likely to be true in the next 2-3 years?
Yeah, sure. And so one thing I kind of like to think about in the whole picture of Amazon and just sort of my background, right? I've been interested in search engine optimization for a while, kind of ever since, you know, reading 4-Hour Workweek in a hammock a long time ago. And I really love the act of doing SEO on a number of different sort of platforms, right? A lot of people think SEO is just Google on your desktop, and that's no longer true. Right. Just backing up a little bit, like from a more nerdy engineering perspective, right? Any modern web application that has like a search function has to deal with at ClickMinded, we call this the document relevancy problem, right? Anytime you type a query, a search into a search engine, that application has to say, what's the most relevant results for this user, right? Whether that's, you know, Google is the easy one, but there's YouTube, there's the App Store, there's eBay, there's Pinterest, you know, there's even Airbnb, right? Like, how does Airbnb render the most relevant like listings for their user, right? So this is kind of what SEO is now. It's kind of understanding what a platform is optimizing for. And it's initially what got me interested in Amazon. A good friend of mine, my former co-founder of my Amazon business that I kind of exited to him, we worked on this for multiple years, but I was initially drawn by the like, how does the Amazon, you know, as an Amazon user, like how does Amazon organize and rank documents, right, on Amazon? What are the key factors? And it was interesting because my co-founder and I, my business partner for the Amazon business, we were a perfect match because he was a good buddy of mine, but he was an American guy based in China, really interested in the product development, the working with the factories, getting the shipping and logistics and the 3PL stuff right. And I was the internet marketing guy, like mostly interested in, you know, ranking, Google rankings, Amazon rankings, and things like that. Back to your question, long-winded answer to your question, Michael. You know, the way we like to talk about different search engines now is that Google is generally like the most kind of complicated, complex one with the most number of ranking signals, and everything else is a distant second, right? And so there's generally seems to be one overlying metric on all these other platforms that seems to matter more than anything else, right? Like on Pinterest, it might be pins, right? Or on the App Store, it might be downloads overall, right? So to me, first, second, and third place has seemed to be sales with Amazon, right? And just sales seems to like trump all. And that's probably not too profound and mind-blowing, but sales seems to be the biggest thing from our perspective, and everything that we've seen. And then from there, what seemed to work for us was a lot of very straightforward things, right? We making sure that that primary keyword was in the title, right? Making sure it was weaved into everywhere you reasonably could, right? Like the bullets, the description, things like that. Trying to incentivize a handful of reviews that also mentioned the primary keyword, right, was a big one for us. And doing anything we could to incentivize reviews as well. So we were pretty relentless about that. The other thing too, especially in the early days, because we kept messing up and kept fumbling a lot. One of the things that a lot of people don't think about that we ended up getting a huge advantage in, I guess, just because of the vertical we picked and the space we picked. There's this concept in SEO called barnacle SEO. And the basic idea is you latch on to bigger players in order to help yourself. So like the classic example back in the day was Yahoo Answers, right? I don't recommend this at all because Yahoo Answers is like a gross cesspool of unintelligent comments now, right? But the basic idea was like Yahoo Answers was consistently ranking at the top of Google for a lot of stuff. So instead of creating a new site and trying to beat it, why not just be like the highest rated comment on it? And there's a lot of great ways to do this now. Small businesses can do it with Yelp. It's easy to do this with Quora. And Amazon is a fantastic way to do this as well, right? Amazon is one of the most authoritative sites on the planet with one of the most highly optimized landing pages in the world. And so one of the things that a lot of people don't keep in mind is driving Google traffic to your Amazon listing. And one of the big benefits of it that a bunch of people don't realize is you can change, we might be getting too into the weeds too fast now, but you can kind of change your canonical tags on Amazon. I don't know if you want to go down this road just yet, but the basic concept is you can kind of like have a primary URL for your page, and if things aren't working, or maybe you get de-indexed, you can change it up. People don't realize how valuable that is, that you can change the URL of your product on one of the most authoritative sites in the world in an instant, in a flash. And that's a very, very valuable sort of thing to think about. So to answer your question, yeah. Like kind of the basics to me were the things we mentioned, but sales is like the end all be all.
Okay, great. Well, like, as you said, that was quite the answer, but I mean, it's a really fantastic answer. I mean, because there's so much in there. So just try and unpack it, as I often do, like being the sort of averagely dumb listener. I suppose maybe I'm the dumber end of some of my listeners are very sharp, but I mean, evergreen things. I mean, what's very interesting about you is you can put things into context. You know, I think I like the fact that you're saying SEO is a sort of more general thing than just Google or just Amazon. And we tend to get very platform centric, right? I mean, the fact that you ran the SEO for Airbnb, and obviously that is in and of itself pretty massive search engine, albeit quite specific, but still it's huge. We've all used it, I guess, by now. We certainly use it. My wife and I are always using Airbnb. So it's an interesting question. The question of what is a platform optimizing for? Nice, simple question, probably multiple factorial answer. But again, if you know it's sales, then you just need to simplify the hell out of everything and drive sales. But that's the first thing to say. But also, a couple of things you said, the little tactics, so we should just pull them out. Incentivizing a handful of reviews, mentioning the primary keyword. I mean, obviously these days, incentivize reviews, dirty word, but getting somebody to mention the keywords is very interesting. That's not a tactic that I've come across. But the barnacle SEO is very interesting. And obviously the canonical URL is something I've heard about. I'm always been a bit hazy. So without sort of getting into detail, that just explain a little bit more about that, because that sounds like quite a powerful tactical thing.
Yeah, sure. So at a really high level, like if you open up any Amazon listing page and you open up the source code, right? It depends on your browser, but you can usually go up to the top and click view source. You can look at the actual code of the site, right? And so if you do command find for canonical, canonical, you'll see the canonical tag. A canonical tag is just how we tell search engines what the original kind of root URL is, right? URLs can often get very long and unwieldy and hard to manage. They have lots of parameters, right? You see all that question mark equals X, question mark equals Y, right? You'll see a lot of different sort of goofy things going on here. The way we use canonicals in order to help search engines handle duplicate content, right? If you think about, you have a shoe store and you have 100 different types of shoes, And there's a number of different ways to sort those shoes, right? You can sort by size 7 and size 10 and size 15. You can sort by red and green and blue, men and women's, hiking, running. And you create all these permutations of these pages that become crazy, right? If Google had to index every single one of these types of pages, you know, their search index would be, you know, a million times larger and very difficult to manage. So a canonical tag is how we handle duplicates. And what your canonical tag will generally be on Amazon is it'll look very similar to your title, right? They usually remove some of the stopgap words like the or and or it's like kind of things like that, the filler words. But that's your primary URL that will end up in Google's index. So you'll write a title. Generally, your canonical URL is the core URL that you want to be promoting, and it'll be like a truncated version of your title. Now here's, and I don't want to like endorse any black hat tactics or anything like that or anything along those lines. But the way to think about this is, look, when you're in SEO and you're starting a brand new domain, like you want to boost up your authority and do all these things, and then you're always kind of at risk of, if you go too aggressive and you go too black hat, like you're at risk of hurting your domain overall, right? With Amazon, to be frank, there's much less risk there. Of course, there's Amazon's terms of service and there's the whole nightmare of like deplatforming with Amazon, and that's kind of unrelated, but you can kind of go nuts on your own product listing page and change your canonical tag at any point, at least at this time. It's still possible. You can, we had a couple of times where you know, funky things would happen and we weren't getting the results we wanted, or we tried building links to our Amazon page and things got a little goofy, and we just kind of changed our title, our primary title on our product listing page, and that changed our core URL. It changed our canonical URL. It's kind of like starting over, but on the most authoritative site in the world. So it's just kind of one tactic to think about. Like when you're an Amazon seller, you are an extension of one of the most authoritative websites on the planet, and you can sort of create new URLs as you see fit. And so if you're new to the internet marketing game, it's easy to overlook how powerful that actually is. It's kind of a dream come true if you put a little work into it. You know what I mean?
I kind of know what you mean. I mean, I've always been a bit hazy about it, but I mean, I guess what you're saying is if you change your title, you change the canonical URL, and that can affect your Google ranking quite profoundly. Is that the kind of dumb person summary, the non-tech summary?
That's it. Yes. Yeah. But it goes both ways. Yes, you can hurt yourself and have to start over, but also you can start over. Like you get infinite tries at kind of boosting it up. So let's say you did some like shady backlinking and things like that, and it didn't work and you wanted to start over. Like that's kind of, that's possible. You know what I mean? You can sort of make those changes and get a brand new start, because at the end of the day, Google's never going to de-index Amazon, right? You're always going to be one URL among millions. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess so. And so what you're talking about then, if I understand correctly, is that you're trying to push for Google rankings, but via your Amazon listing, which is, I guess, kind of similar in the terms of what you do to rank you on Amazon full stop, but I guess it's a different mentality because you're after a different source of traffic ultimately, aren't you? Because people go direct to Amazon to search for products now. I usually do. I go straight to my Amazon app on my phone. I was talking about that to a client just before this call, and just saying, like, I just wanted to capture how I actually shopped for something today. And it's not some clean theory, you know, it's always, there's always a certain path to things. And it's interesting to observe yourself as a consumer, if you like, because as a marketer, we always behave so differently because we get so analytical. And as a consumer, I'm just bam, 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 bam. Even though I know that people are probably manipulating reviews, I still like a clean set of 5-star average reviews, you know. So anyway, so what I'm saying is that's quite different from if I personally go on Google, which I also did for the same product search, interestingly. Why I go on Google, how I search Google is quite different, but I may end up back on Amazon, which I actually did. In this case, for example, I was shopping for an iPhone, really robust case, because I keep dropping the thing on the floor. Who knew? And I went straight to Amazon. Then I went on Google and looked for best tough iPhone 10 case. And then I clicked on a site that seemed good. And then it took me back to Amazon. It's not surprising. But what's interesting to me is that that same set of products had basically three ways of being discovered by me. One is direct through Amazon and ranking on Amazon. The second one is via some kind of affiliate link with a site. And the third one is possibly, which didn't happen today, but could have done, through direct ranking via Google web results or shopping results, right? So that's a whole different context than for those emerging from the Amazon bubble and thinking a bit bigger, which I hope is what you can help us do. This is quite a culture shift, even though it probably for you as an SEO person seems like duh, obvious. So let's explore that a bit further. I mean, how on earth does this fit into a sort of business model? I mean, I've just thrown a load of stuff out there. You sold on Amazon. I mean, if you're sitting there and you're an Amazon seller, you've got stock you want to sell, you want to build a business. How do we make sense of this as a sort of strategic set of tools to deploy, and when do we use it?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Really good question, Michael. So I think the broader way to think about it, just like with in the context of digital marketing, is very simply, who are your customers, where are they, and what are they doing, right? And just SEO is just the capturing of that intent. That's really all it is, right? It's very different from social media, where like audiences are kind of like, they're more defined, like kind of individuals that have certain characteristics and demographics and things like that. SEO is understanding demand and just being there and being there at the right place and right time. And it can apply to any platform, right? Of course, the metrics are different, but yeah, being at the top of Amazon for your primary keyword is being at the right place, right time for that type of demand. Pushing your Amazon listing at the top of Google for that primary keyword is being at the right place, right time for that type of demand as well. So it's really, to me, like the kind of inputs you do to get the work done are all different, but at the end of the day, it's all the same process of understanding what the platform is trying to do and then delivering like awesome relevant results to that user. The big thing to think about when you're doing SEO on any platform is thinking about what's best for the user and also thinking about what's best for that business, right? What's best for Google when you're optimizing for Google? What's best for Amazon when you're optimizing for Amazon? What's best for Pinterest or the App Store or whatever whenever you're optimizing? And yeah, the inputs are going to be different. Like you need more links with Google and you need more sales with Amazon. But the core kind of thing there is like you're operating in their universe. You're operating their ecosystem, and you got to sort of understand the rules, reverse engineer them to the best you can, and do what's best for that business that you're optimizing on. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, that's a very good, clear mind. So it comes down to simple sounding stuff, but you've actually really done this for some very serious businesses. So it's got a lot of authority behind it. I'm glad to hear that. Yeah. What's best for user, what's best for the platform. And I think the other thing I'd like to just remind people, probably doesn't apply quite so much to more serious sellers, but I know a few people who are doing $1 million, $2 million a year who have dreams of getting off Amazon and imagine that they're getting away from being in a controlling, on somebody else's platform, somebody else's playground. And I just remind everyone that there's no way to get away from that. You're on the Google App Store, like I do podcasts. I'm totally vulnerable to Apple's algorithms and they don't share anything with you. It's horrific. It's even worse than Amazon. Amazon, is famously the most control freaky in the world, and you are swimming with sharks. But Google, you know, says do no evil, but that's not really true. They slap businesses all the time. I mean, there is no way. YouTube, you know, is not a natural phenomenon which you walk on as the earth and the sun is given. It's run by a commercial company that exists and for profit. So I think we've got to just come to terms with that, right? And I think sometimes people look out of Amazon, you know, blinking out of the prison bars going, oh, one day I'll be free and I'll have a Shopify store. I'm like, okay, so for Shopify, the traffic's going to come from Google SEO or Google ads or Twitter ads or Facebook ads. Mm-hmm. So anyway, it sounds like an obvious point, but I think it's worth hammering home.
I'm really glad you brought this up, Michael. I've got so many. This is like a blog post that's been sitting in my brain for 3 years.
Excellent. Time to write it. I think you should write it. It's a necessary one.
Yeah, and I think I love talking about this because you're completely right. Is that, and people do this all the time. They say, okay, platform risk. Amazon is a drug I don't want to be on anymore. I got to move off. And the inevitable conclusion is, okay, I'm not going to go to Amazon. Okay, I'm going to go to Google instead. Okay, actually, wait, I want to be off Google. That's platform risk. I want my own audience. Oh, wait, okay, actually, there's even risk in the state that I live in. Like the state could shut down my website. Where are my servers located? Like, oh wait, actually there's risk in the country I'm living in. And like the inevitable conclusion, because our lives are built on platforms, right? Like, okay, yes, Amazon's a simple one, but if you keep moving up and up and up and up, like the roads that our towns are paved by, the language we speak, the city and state and country that we live in, like the inevitable conclusion is like, okay, I need to move into a cave in the middle of the wilderness and move away and move away from everyone.
I love it. That's basically Tim Ferriss's conclusion in half of his later 4-hour work week, most fascinating blog post. Okay, what would you do if the United States, you know, declared nuclear war on Russia or whatever it is, you know, if they come after you for back taxes or something? Is that kind of survival? In the end, you're right. You become a survivalist and living in the jungle, holding a knife. And it's kind of like almost the fine American tradition, but it's probably not where you want to be as a digital marketer. So thank you for pointing that out. I mean, that's a beautifully, again, this is what I really try and do in the these days on the both podcasts, particularly the 10K Collective podcast, is aim for strategic level insights, because actually they do clarify the tactical stuff. I don't think it's just pontification. I think platform risk, for example, if I could move, because my wife is a musician and works in London, which is one of the greatest cities in the world to freelance as a musician. So we ain't going anywhere. Plus, it's a world city. It's a great city. But, you know, if it were just me, I'd have been gone from the platform risk of Brexit, which on the platform of the UK government's crazy policies, similar to anyone who finds Trump's approach to life somewhat, shall we say, spontaneous, to put it politely, that your country's very entire violent import policy can change based on one guy tweeting and nobody around them knows, you know. So platform risk in America is huge right now for e-commerce sellers, same in the UK. So that's a kind of platform risk. But in the end, as you say, it's not a question of necessarily shifting platforms, although I would have shifted platform, if you like, to Germany. I like the way of looking at it. I'm sure the Germans would love to be thought of as a platform. That sounds really respectful. But also, it's about managing it and recognizing there is always platform risk. And it's a question okay, great. So this is a brilliant question. How do we manage platform risk in the broader sense? So let's stick to, you know, online platforms. But there is also the question of platform risk of, okay, I'm sourcing in China and I'm selling in the US right now, but then Trump's put those tariffs on. Should I go to Vietnam, or is he going to put tariffs on there next week? This is a profoundly important question, actually. How do we handle platform risk? So let's come back to the Amazon thing. Let's keep it like actually a manageable discussion, fascinating as it would be. That's like a two bottles of wine discussion. That is, that's an all night. Sure. Amazon versus Google and Shopify, that kind of thing. Let's speak to that. How do we handle platform risk in the bigger picture if you're ambitious to build a robust, defensible business, either to sell to somebody else or to keep as your own kind of cash cow?
Yeah, it's really interesting. And I'll be frank with you, Michael. Like every business I've ever been in has been incredibly undiverse in terms of its traffic, right? Like I don't have, you sort of have this weird trade-off, and I'm not the best person to speak to this, but in general, what I see the pattern seems to be is you grow faster when you go all in on one platform, right? And then you sort of, when the stakes get higher and higher, you're supposed to kind of unwind from that, right? But this applies everywhere. And I know you said to stick to Amazon, but a quick example with Google. I mean, these massive companies, Demand Media is one in the US, 2011, 2012, they went public and they were kind of the shop that churned and burned content, right? The kind of sites that would post 500 to 1,000 articles a day would be things like how to boil water, right? Like very thin, low quality, pointless content that was just designed to soak up traffic. They went public, and then Google's Panda update, you can literally watch the stock. If you go to Google Finance or Yahoo Finance, you can see the day the Google algorithm hit where the stock plummeted 80% or whatever it is. Zynga is another example with Facebook, right? Zynga, basically, you know, their start was with Farmville, and it was basically finding a loophole and exploiting a loophole in the invite a friend feature in Facebook, right? Spammed absolutely everyone to get on this app. Company took off, and you can see the day this in the stock price when Facebook changed their terms of service, and it was kind of no longer there, right? So platform risk always exists, right? It's never going to go away. Unless you want to go create Google and Facebook and Amazon yourself and go ahead and do that. And then your platform risk becomes, you know, speaking in front of Congress around whether or not you have a monopoly and all this kind of stuff. So just like, it never really goes away. So to be frank, my general advice is like the smaller you are, the less you worry about this. And the smaller you are, in my opinion, the more you should kind of go all in on one platform and not worry about it as much. These, I understand why people say, I want to get off Amazon and have my own brand. It makes total logical sense. But I don't think you can ever completely get rid of platform risk. I think it's always going to be there in one way or another. Yeah, you go on Shopify, then you have Google risk. Or maybe you have Shopify risk, right? Or whatever it is. So I'm not a big fan of diversifying away from the platforms. It's more about just being neurotic about following them and staying up with the terms of service and making sure you're delivering value for your users and for the platform that you're on. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a very interesting one, isn't it? I mean, because the traditional investing response, which is quite different from the entrepreneurial way of doing things, is diversify, or diversification equals safety, is what we've been sort of, you know, well, at least didn't absorb with your mother's milk, because most people don't get taught very much in their families about investing. But I mean, I guess that's traditionally the strategy. But actually, some of the smartest investors in the world say things like, put your eggs in one basket and watch that basket. And I guess as entrepreneurs, we are, it's intrinsically, and I think this is another thing that we need to, if you think, look at business activity from an investment perspective, acknowledge that what we're doing is a high risk, potentially very high reward activity. So in a sense, trying to be too safe within the realms of a business, especially a small startup, aggressive one, or not when I say startup, we've got a couple of guys in there and the mastermind, one of which the business has been in business for about four generations and one for like 220 years. So I guess you can't really call it a startup, but they're still aggressively growing, which is kind of impressive, you know? But
Wild, yeah.
It is wild. I mean, they're great guys and I'm really proud to be associated with people like that. They're wonderful business people, and they've got that real exciting growth mentality that you get with the small businesses, but which have been established, that they've also got other things going on. But coming back to that question, I guess maybe a better response is to look again, we seem to be talking about like going up and down in sort of hierarchical levels, like platform risk. Okay, what about the country you're on? What about the planet you're on? You know, etc. Right?
That's the biggest one right there. Right?
Kind of, yeah, I mean, okay, intrinsically, we're going to run out of stuff. Maybe we should move to Mars tomorrow. Yeah, that's kind of sounds ridiculous and pretentious. But I mean, if you actually apply that way of thinking across the board, maybe you need to go, okay, yes, my business is highly risky, but if you as a person, as in not a limited company, but as sole, you know, just a person who owns stuff, and yeah, you're not within sophisticated tax protection or anything else or legal protection, but you could own, you know, quite a few properties. So if your Amazon business gets suspended for 3 months, at least you and your family get to eat. And yes, you've got to pay your staff, so they get to eat as well. So, you know, there are certain forms of diversification you might want to look at there, I guess. But what's interesting is everyone seems obsessed with getting their e-commerce based business to be very diversified and safe, as opposed to going, well, this is a high risk, high gain venture, but there's nothing to stop you having a, which in reality, many of us do, right? You have a consulting wing to your Amazon activities such right. that you have good cash flow that comes from that. And if your Amazon account gets suspended, it's going to be very embarrassing because you're supposed to be an expert. But on the other hand, cash keeps flowing, right? And that's within just the e-commerce realm. So I always think that people look through very narrow lens and then work very, very hard to try and diversify, as opposed to go, well, why don't you step back a bit? What are you really worried about? Is it you not paying your personal rent? In which case, you know, buy a few rental properties and, you know, keep a bit of consulting going, and that should do the job, which is way easier than trying to get Google to rank your little Shopify store as a way to run away from Amazon risk, right? I mean, it was just strikes me like that's such a hard way to solve the problem. And what are your thoughts on this? Obviously, you've been through multiple things. You've been an employee, you've been self-employed with your own business growing. How do you handle diversification and risk and stuff?
Yeah, I really like that idea, like the kind of portfolio manager investment advice of diversification versus realizing that these are high risk ventures. That's the game. Yeah, that's the trade-off that we signed up for.
That's
right?
What we're doing. Yeah, exactly.
And when you put it that way, you're right. Like, I mean, when you're starting to diversify, it should be, in my opinion, and caveat, this is not legal advice. Do not take this investment advice, whatever the legal disclaimer there is. But yeah, I think the diversity should be coming when you're ready to preserve, when you're ready to like kind of preserve and hedge and sort of slow your growth rate a little bit, right? Like put less time on the thing you're all in on and pop up those other channels kind of thing. And so for me, I was in the space of not diversifying mostly because I was a one trick pony. Like I wasn't good at anything else. Right. And so I wasn't, able to diversify into other things and just got very specific in this one channel. And but it ended up working. It ended up being I went all in, and it ended up working. But yeah, I'm just not convinced you can ever get rid of the platform risk. And so there's of course a reasonable moment in time eventually where it makes sense to diversify, but trying to treat your, you know, fledgling 6 month to 1 year Amazon FBA business like a hedge fund that has like exposure to treasuries and currencies and like low risk stuff and high risk stuff, it just seems a little crazy to me. This is high risk stuff. Go all in on it. That's kind of what we're here for. That's what we signed up for. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I think that's true. And I think as long as you know that you signed up for it, when some people like to treat it like it's just a day job, or they treat it as a replacement for a day job, I'm like, well, that's a little bit like swapping, you know, a cart horse that kind of plods along for a bucking bronco that hasn't even been tamed yet. I mean, as long as you're up for the ride, it's okay. And I think you need to clarify what it is. And I had a call with a couple of beginners. I've taken the course that we run for beginners. It's inevitable we'd have one. In the end, I caved in, but tried to give people a sense of that you need to start from little baby steps to walking and then to running, rather than go straight into running. And then the other thing is the reality check. And I said, look, so you want to replace this kind of income, you know, let's think about the stability of the income and the risk relative to, you know, the risk of, say, getting suspended or fired from a day job or whatever. So, yeah, I think it's good to, as long as you're clear-minded what you risk you're running and you know where the fault lines are. I think in the end, you know what, in Britain, it's traditionally generally considered a bad idea to not pay taxes, and that could land you in jail. But rather than leaving the country, I just choose to try and obey tax law. And if in doubt, I hire a lawyer. So I guess you could say the same with Amazon, which is that, you know, yes, there are risks around the terms of service, but if you're serious and you've got a few million pounds a year business riding on it, or a few million dollars or whatever, I guess you need to get serious about understanding the terms of service, and if in doubt, hire somebody, of which there are many experts out there who spend their lives poring over the detail of that, to just proof your business, right? So in the end, I guess really understanding in great detail where you're at is more of a safety feature than diversifying out of ignorance, right? I mean, discuss. I mean, this is what I'm coming to conclusion of. This seems to be what the smart people I know do. Is that also your take on things as a very Google focused person yourself, for example?
Yeah, for sure. And I just, the way I like to think about it, and like, this is sort of what we've been teaching, and the way I've run my own life and my own businesses, is setting yourself up to reverse engineer everything. Right, to understand all of it. There's platforms everywhere. Like, however you want to do it is however you want to do it. Yeah, I spend most of my time reverse engineering search engines and how they rank documents, but there's plenty of people that reverse engineer how to get stuff to go viral on Instagram, right? How to close clients over the phone, how to, you know, set up your booth at a trade show. I mean, there's like there's platforms everywhere, and there's monetization channels and leads everywhere as well. So when you change the mindset more to like, platforms are everywhere around me, I can move up and down and sideways on platforms, and I'm constantly operating in other people's environments, right? Like, you can have your own environments, but in general, you're operating in other environments. You're operating on the planet and your country and different languages and cities and states and other corporations. And you take roads to go to certain places, and you use sites to go to different places to navigate and things like that. So if you're just constantly reverse engineering everything and generally focus on making the customers you're serving and the platforms you're optimizing within better, then you're probably going to be okay. So like, instead of stressing too much about this one thing, just change your mindset to constantly sort of optimizing where you operate in. You probably won't die.
I love it. I mean, this is the sort of discussion I love, which is probably kind of very unscientific way of running a podcast, for example, because I mean, I guess I feel like I should be led by keywords and what's the latest Twitter trend, and I'm very bad at all that stuff, but this has gone a very interesting direction. I think just talk about big pictures, the biggest pictures really, but actually I think as a mentality, you know what, I think it is an important shift. So set yourself up to, I love this, just like general life advice for an entrepreneur, set yourself up to reverse engineer every platform, embrace the risk, and you're generally operating in other environments. And I think you're right. As long as we compare risk rationally, we're okay. Because as you say, like, you know, we get in the car and drive somewhere without thinking about that as a day job risk. But actually, if you do that often enough, the chances of actually having an accident are really quite high. I mean, they are, folks. I'm sorry to say that. So, you know, or catching flu in the underground, and which is terribly bad for your health if you commute into the City of London every day. So you've got to weigh that up against Google, you know, giving you a slap or Amazon suspending your account, I guess, you know. And I suppose what I'm trying to say is everything has risk, recognize the risk, and then, you know, make your peace with it is what we're trying to say. Extraordinarily philosophical episode. We better draw that one to a conclusion, because we are, I promise, if you're out there hungry to make cash and like, what the hell is all this philosophy about? Personally, I think this comes from people who've been running businesses their own for a few years. I mean, certainly you've done it on a much more impressive scale than anything I've done, but I think this is the kind of thing that keeps you awake at night. So hopefully we've spoken to some of that. But the next one, I promise, we'll be talking about sending Google traffic to Amazon and versus that to Shopify. So stay tuned for some slightly more actionable stuff in the next episode.